Hello, Shirley Adams for the Sewing Connection Series 16, Program 12. As I unpacked a big case of clothing repeatedly in Australia, I noticed almost every garment I had brought had bias cut fabric tubes used somewhere. This feature is so useful, it's no wonder it crops up frequently as a utilitarian necessity or as a finishing embellishment. The challenge here is to fill open spaces with fabric tubes. These can be the same fabric as the garment, if it's all in the construction stage, or if a few pounds later something is snug. Open up seams and bridge the gap with contrasting or harmonizing tubes. There are a whole lot of ways you can use tubes, and if you look at the models, you'll see some of the ways that I've used in the past. Now, this could be, as we have on these first three vests, they could be the garment itself. There are so many tubes there, they're woven, and this is the garment. So this is one way that you can use these fabric tubes. Now, another way you'll see on these models, and what these are tubes also, and these may be padded and they may not be padded. They may be filled with a cord or not, depending on the look you want. On the navy jacket, these are soft, and after I got it all finished, I thought it might have looked better had I padded them. But too late, it was too much work to take it off and do it over again. But anyway, it's a pretty little feature. It's like, hooray, I did something that I didn't think I was going to do on that jacket. I made a big mistake, and that was a celebration afterwards. The serpentine tape and the confetti. And then on the other one, the red one, those tubes are filled because I didn't want them to crush when the cleaners got a hold of it. I wanted them to stay rounded out. So these are filled tubes, but also you can see that these are embellishing, obviously. It's also camouflaging the fact that I ran short of fabric, and so I had to have an extra something there in front in order to cover. It's almost like bridging the gap. And then we have a third group here, and where these are used, these are strictly utilitarian, but they might as well be decorative en route. On these three vests, we have bias cut tubes used as fasteners. They might be, as in that navy one, the shibori vest, they might be the square cut button loops, or you can't see it very easily, maybe in the black one, but there's a swirly tube that goes round, and every time it comes off the fabric, it makes a button loop also. Or then there are frogs, and of course this is always a good way to use tubes, to use them for frogs or for ball buttons or any kind of fasteners. They are just wonderful, and I don't know how I could sew without them. Actually, I had about 60 or 70 garments in Australia as I was traveling and doing live seminars everywhere, and I didn't realize until someone in the audience said, you have a tube on everything that you make, and it came close to it, almost every one. Well, the matter of filling or not to fill, let me tell you how or show you how to do that. Now, anytime I'm going to use this as a fastener, naturally, you are going to need to have them corded because it's going to have some pull on it, some strain, and these are bias cut. They're going to stretch a little bit. You really don't want that stretch in the button loops, so there you would want it. Plus, you want that heavier look to it. Therefore, I would go ahead and fill these. And to fill them, now you just take a tube. I already have this stitched. It is, of course, cut on the bias, and it's about, you cut it about twice as much as you want it so that you have a seam allowance there. And then you use the biggest tube you can, because there are a choice of many tubes here, and you use the biggest tube you can to go into the space that you have. And sometimes you have to try a few until you get there just right. And it seems tight if I pull here, but it's because it's on the bias. So you need to instead push it on from the tip this way, and that way it isn't too tight and it'll move easily. When I get down almost to the tip, that's when I'll put the little corkscrew through it. And if it's loosely woven fabric, you better put it through a couple of times. Now this one's pretty tightly woven, but I'm still going to give it a couple of rounds here just to make sure it holds on. Well, if it goes through easily, I will, and it didn't, so I won't, so it isn't going to matter. Okay, and as soon as you start pulling that through, and you can see how I'm pulling it through here, I have my thumb against this little brace here, and I have that corkscrew in my hand, and you just pull it with your little fingers, and you push on it with your thumb, and it does all this with your one hand while your other hand is busy opening that little seam allowance, because it's going to look prettier if it's open. It's like pressing it open when it rubs over the side of this tube. And in addition to that, I want this one corded, so I'll take a little cord. This is a little cable cord. You can buy these in packages or by the yard. You'll find them in notions departments. And so I'm going to just put it right here at the tip of it. And as I push the tube with my other hand, you can see that it immediately makes contact and it just pulls through. And once you've opened that seam allowance, the rest of the way along, it'll just open itself as you push the fabric off the tube with one hand and pull it through with the corkscrew, and everything just opens. And when you get through, you have this marvelous corded tube, and it makes great button loops or whatever fasteners you want to make. And so it's really a good deal. Now, this was a silk, kind of a medium weight silk, but still it was a silk, and so it turns rather easily. There are, what I love about these fasterns is the fact that there are some impossible fabrics that won't turn at all by any other means, but they'll turn with this. Now, what I have here is something, you'll see this a few programs down the line, something I'm making right now. What I have done to this crepe fabric, which in itself, a wool crepe is hard to turn because of the texture, but what I've done is stitch all these yarns on it. I've couched yarns on it because I wanted to stripe this fabric. It was a solid fabric. So to turn that tube, it's going to be all that texture against texture, and it's not too likely you're going to be able to do it. And here again, this is probably the largest tube I can use, but it's just going right over all those yarns as I push it through. And when I get it to the other end, this one, I don't know what I'm doing with this. I think it was just a spare tube, so I don't necessarily need to cord this one. Now, there are also different size corkscrews, of course. If you have a smaller tube, it might be a shorter one and it would need this one. The larger tubes would need a larger one. These huge tubes also have a huge wire that goes through them. So use the appropriate one, whichever it is. And this one looks like it'll need the blue. And so once I get that in, come on, blue, go in, okay. And now this one is pretty loosely woven. It's wool, and anytime you have something of wool, it's probably not going to be as tightly woven as another fiber would be. So I will put this through more than once. And then let's see what happens. Get it back here in place. And again, open that little seam. And just try this by any other means, and you're not going to do it because of the texture of it. And those yarns that are sewn in, as you can see, as it opens, you can see all those yarns. No problem whatsoever. And the reason for this is because that textury fabric never touches itself. It is over the brass tube on the outside. And then as you pull it through, it also is just pushing against the slippery tube on the inside. It never touches itself, so no problem at all. It just turns. So they are like magic. Well, a few new places I've used them this time to bridge the gap. And I can see a lot of uses that way. For instance, if you have princess lines in a jacket and suddenly in the hip area it is just too tight, I kind of got this one caught on a yarn. If it's just too tight there in the hip area, how about opening those princess seams just a little bit there and maybe putting a few little drapey tubes in there to fill the space, especially if you made the suit and if you still have some of the fabric left. And I really never throw those fabric scraps away for just in case occasions of that sort. Well, these aren't necessarily for that reason, but these do fill a gap. For instance, back here on the mannequin, this blue one, notice how all those tubes are going from dart to dart in the neckline. Now, that was just because I had transposed several shows ago. I showed you how to transpose darts from the usual places to unusual places. And when these darts are in the neckline, it seemed like a really good excuse to use some tubes to go from one to the other. Now these, any of them that hang there, any of them that bridge the gap as opposed to being utilitarian, these I probably am not going to pad with cord because I want them to hang softly. And so I've just turned a bunch of tubes and they are all silks or polys or rayons, but they're just very soft and you want them to stay that way. And so it's cooked spaghetti instead of when it's still uncooked and straight. Okay, what I'm going to do is, first of all, put a dart here. And those are fairly large darts. They're probably about this big. I'll just draw a couple of lines here. Whoopsie. The fabric moved a little bit, so I've got a funny line on that side, but I'm not going to use that side anyway, so it doesn't matter too much. I'll be a little more careful about it on this side. Okay, here's where I'm going to have a stitching line of my dart, and I already have these tubes made, and I might just cut off any funny ends that are here so that they're straight on the end. But what I would do with these tubes is just put them here, and if there is a seam showing, it's not going to be as pretty, so I'll put that seam to the back side, and I'd pin it in place here. And if you don't put any tubes right down to the point, it's going to be an easier job for you. And I need to pin them, pardon me, I'm going to move this. I need to pin them with the heads away from the dart and the points into the dart, because I don't want to get the heads of the pins caught in there. And so you would just pin all those that you plan to use like this, right side up, which would be with the seam underneath. And this is a silk charmeuse that I'm pinning here. And so, of course, it is very soft fabric. I just don't want any excess, is why I cut off the funny ends that were a little misshapen. And so I just need to get a little bit in here, not very much. Actually, a quarter inch would be plenty to have past the line that I drew. And once these are all pinned in the way you want them, then you would take this to the machine after you've pinched it in and just go ahead and sew it. And so what I do here, I'll start at the top, I guess, and you would just pinch it in to make those lines fit together and go ahead and pin all the way. And by the time it's all pinned and you stitch the dart on the other side, you can see how easily this is going to work. So that might be a nice thing to do. A little bit different. Nobody else in town is going to have one like you if you do this. And you kind of like that, don't you, to have everything look a little different? Here's another version of the same thing. And with this, I first of all put these tubes, I didn't have any darts, so I put them to the fabric edge, and I've pinned them in several places around the edge here. Then after the lining was put down on top of it and the whole thing was stitched all around and turned right side out, these tubes just hang nicely, again, to fill in a neckline and bridge the gap. So another way of doing the same thing, but you surely have from everything you ever made, you surely have some of these nice soft scraps. And I have a combination here of, this is rayon, this is polyester, here's a microfiber, here's a silk, there's another microfiber. I have things mixed, but the point of it is they're all soft. When you mix fabrics like that, be sure that they are all compatible as far as care goes. Are you going to dry clean them, or are you going to wash them, and make sure that they will all take the same kind of treatment later? Well, a new one that I'm doing right now that is fun, I don't have it finished yet, I saved it to show you what I'm doing. I find things that I just can't resist, and when I buy them, like this organdy ribbon, you can see it's variegated. It goes from yellow to purple to blue greens to a kind of a sharp green. I just love things like this, and so I'm going to buy multi-yards of it with no idea whatsoever I'm going to do with it. But at some time down the line, I know I will absolutely have to have it. And so I have it on hand all the time. This is every time I refer to my stash. It's because I do get things like this. I feel that we pass this way but once, and if you see it, you better buy it. You'll never see it again. And so this is something I found in my stash, and I decided that's just going to be perfect to put on the front of this blouse. Again, to just give it a little different look. So these aren't tubes, it's simply a flat ribbon, but I have stitched it here. And these stripes, just to make it a little more unusual, I didn't put them at regular intervals. Instead, I have these close together and it keeps moving a little bit farther apart, just because I kind of like the look. And it intrigues me a little bit to have something slightly unusual. Well, here's the sleeve where I've bridged the gap. Now, this might be a utilitarian thing. For instance, if you find that some sleeve is just too tight, how about cutting it right down the center, binding the edges, or folding them back? Now, here I really just have them folded back. Well, I'll show you on this one that's not finished. I really just have them folded back. I cut the pattern in two so that I have two pieces of sleeve, and I just made an extra seam allowance right at the center of it. This is going to come down the center of the sleeve. I just made a big seam allowance here, which I finished with the serger, and then after it was finished, turned it back, and it stitched down to hold it tight by putting this ribbon on, and that's what holds it in place. And then I want to put these two pieces of sleeve together and have that gap. Now, if you already have a sleeve on something that's just too tight, like in the biceps area, where is the most typical place for it to be too tight, you could do the same thing. You could, without taking it out of the dress or whatever the garment is, you could really slash right up the center and maybe bind something. And then instead of having those edges together, I'm saying maybe bind it because you wouldn't have any fabric to turn back. Instead of putting those edges together, go ahead and leave them apart. It would be together at the top. But then it's just a matter of taking a tube and sort of serpenting it back and forth to connect those. And it's kind of a pretty look. It's unusual, but it's pretty. And you could do that in any kind of fabric. This is a wool crepe that I've done this in. And what I did first of all on this is put those two pieces together, wrong sides up, and put some chalk marks on them. I put a ruler right next to it and used a chalk pencil, and because it rubs off easily, or a chalk wheel, whatever comes off easily. And about every inch I made a little line, so I'll just put it down here. And I did something of this sort, just made a little line every inch, and this stays on just a little bit longer than a chalk wheel does, is why I use this. So it doesn't have to show much, it only has to show enough for you to see. But every inch I wanted to have a little mark here. So all the way down the sleeve I did that. And then after I had this done, I worked from the back side. And that's so that I could keep the seam allowance up, but also so that I could see my chalk marks. So I just worked from the back side, and as I came down the sleeve, I would tack it by hand over on this side. You know, just take a couple of stitches here to attach it. I didn't want the stitches to show on the outside. I just do it through the back, but take a couple of stitches this side, and then maybe go ahead and tie a knot each time if you want to. But what I did is work the needle through the tube, and then come out an inch down below and stitch it over to the other side, so that it just stitched here and then stitched there and here and there, so that when I got to the bottom I had this pretty little serpentine going down the sleeve. And I hated to throw the tube away, and how do you finish it anyway? So at the bottom you can see I just swirled it around here, and the very end of it I hid under the tube as it came around, so that it all has a finished look. So kind of a neat little technique that you might want to use to expand something, as well as whatever reason it might be. Okay, another one that I've used tubes. Have you ever wanted to lengthen something, but you didn't just want to tack it on way at the bottom? Well, this might be a good way if it's an appropriate place where you can leave it open. So here I have tubes just to make this a little bit longer. Or you might have these tubes at the midriff point, or you might have them up here sort of forming a yoke as it attaches to the lower part. But it's a good way to lengthen things. And you might, instead of just having these tubes hanging here, you might even use some other colored tubes and weave them in and out. Maybe weave one in and out, and the other one weave up and down over the one you already put in. But it would be a different way, again, of treating something and giving a little unusual look. And then let's go over to the machine, and I'd like to show you something that I've done over here. I see this in magazines all the time, and I love the look of this passementerie. And sometimes you see it with soutache braid, and sometimes you see it with self fabric. And so I always wondered how they did that. Well, the easiest way to find out is experiment a little bit and see what happens. So I want to first make some bias just real quickly, because something else that I really like is this fast tube, this foot that's on the machine right now. And you know how sometimes with these slippery fabrics, it's almost impossible to stitch them straight? You know, your line goes back and forth all sorts of ways because they are hard to control as you fold them in half and try to stitch a straight line there to make a tube. And you really do want these tubes to be uniformly straight. Well, here's probably the slipperiest of the bunch. This is a really difficult to control fabric. So what you would do with this is just put it through the tube here, and it substitute for the presser foot that's on the machine. Actually, you fold it in half, so I'll go ahead and fold it before I put it through the tube. But see this little metal finger that comes out here? It's this metal finger that holds that fabric right in place. And as you push this through, and it'll come out the back side, and then you can get a hold of it and start stitching. And you just want to keep it folded in half. And if you have an impossible job of keeping it folded in half, now when you do the stitching, it'll stitch a straight line regardless. It'll be an even distance from the fold. But if you have a hard time making the two raw edges stay together in order to do this, how about just giving it a little press? Now the problem with that, with pressing it in half as I've done here, is the fact when it's turned right side out afterwards, that little crease might still be there. So you have to weigh the advantages and disadvantages there and see if it's applicable to your situation. What also this has is a little clamp right back here, and you can move this back and forth to make it as wide, I have it clamped there, as wide or as narrow as you want to. And that's another nice feature. If I'm going to have it right here, I'll just go ahead and clamp it and put the foot down and do a little stitching to show you how you really can make this uniform every time. Even if my raw edges don't stay together, the fact that it goes around this metal finger here makes the tube just completely uniform. And so it's especially great on slippery fabrics is where I really like it. But you get used to using it for everything just because you know it's going to work out right every time. So anyway, this is how easy it is to do a uniform tube if you use this particular thing. Now what I also have on my tube, because of my Janome machine here, my Memorycraft 9000, it has a long shank on it, and the tube itself has a short shank, so you can get an extender for it, and that's what I have on it right now. I'm going to take this off, and I think I better use a screwdriver to do it, because I'm going to show you then how to do that passementary. So I need to remove this foot and put a regular foot on. And now the regular foot you use, you have to think about what works most easily and try it out, because you don't know really until you try it. What I tried are three different feet here that I thought might work, and the one I could do it most easily with is the one with an open toe. And so this is the one I'm going to use as I put the new shank on, or the machine's regular shank, and put that foot on. And what you also need to hold all this tautly in place as you put on that, whoops, get the screw started first and then put the foot on. As you put on that passementary, you really need to hold the fabric out very stiffly. So the easiest way to do that is to put it in a hoop, of course, and keep it really stiff. I don't want to put any stabilizer under it. I really would rather have just the one layer of fabric, and the hoop is the easiest way. Okay, let's put a foot on it and let's go ahead and stitch. This is just straight stitching, and so it's a very easy thing to do, and I can even make it slightly, they are slightly larger stitches. Okay, I'm going to put this fabric in a hoop. Now I'm using very lightweight fabric here. This was my practice piece before, and I'll just keep on using it. And this, by the way, you want to start out with a big long piece. So I have really long bias tubes here, and do cut them on the bias. Don't cut them on the straight, because they're always going to be prettier on the bias. So I have quite long tubes, and even if you have to join them, you still need them on the bias. Well, what I'm going to do with this then is put it in the hoop and do a little stitching, and decide in advance exactly how you want to stitch it. In fact, again, maybe draw a chalk line in it so that you can get this to look just the way you want it to. And once you have it out nicely, stiffly in place, you could even use more than one layer. You could use a couple of layers of thin fabric like this, but then you just put it under, and you're going to put the tube under the foot also. I want a longer one. Here's a longer one. Oh, this is a real good long one. Okay. And just put the tube under here. And now why I'm using this foot is, of course, so that I can see what's going on. The front of it's open. But also I'm using this foot because there's a little raised platform underneath, so it gives room for the tube to go around. You might on your machine also try some other foot, like, and it's just a matter of moving the hoop. And don't start out too fast. Just go slowly, because you're practicing after all. But see how uniformly, and I purposely have a different color thread in so you can see, but it's going real uniformly through the middle. So practice this a little bit to see how you can do this job. And you don't want any, you want just fluid lines. You don't want any sudden little jerky corners any place. But this is really simple to do. And it's fascinating, actually. And as you get more adept at it, you can go faster maybe. And I ended up going around in circles here. And then as I'd trap myself in the middle of some of these, I found, well, just go right across and keep on going and go make yourself a new situation. And some of these I got smaller and smaller and went into the middle. And when I did that, I'd use tweezers to hold the tube there so it would stay in place nicely so that I could do that and cover up the raw edges and so on. But practice on something, and it's amazing how easy it is. Now, I saw a really pretty blouse that cost an enormous amount, something I would certainly never pay for it. And I found I can do the very same thing. It was just a gorgeous white organdy blouse, but this is what covered it. And see how you can just take that tube all the way around in circles. And I haven't done this for a few days since I did that project that you are seeing. And so it's, again, practicing, but it's doable. And I'm sure that you can all do it without any trouble. Now, something else that I saw that was kind of interesting in a magazine was this. And as I looked at that and thought, how could I do that, that pretty thing on the shoulder? It occurred to me the easiest way, if you don't want to draw the design yourself, is to take one of these quilting templates that you can see in quilting shops or quilting departments, trace that onto just anything, paper down below, put your thin fabric on top, and stitch through the whole thing as you put it all in a hoop, and do the same thing as you see there. Anything you see commercially, you can do it. Well, if you like to fill in that open front with something intriguing, come back next time for a whole lot more ideas. This is your chance to use all manner of embellishing in a small area with minimum effort. See you on the front line.